Good morning, church. How's everybody doing this morning? Good. I'm glad y'all are here this morning with us. This morning, we're going to do something a little bit different. I'm going to ask you guys to stand with us like normal, but we're going to read a part of the preamble of the Declaration of Independence, and then we're going to do a special with our choir. This is a two-week practice choir, and we've been doing great. So I thank them for the patience, because after my trip and everything, we had 2 weeks of practice. So we've only practiced twice. So, but God will be with us this morning as we sing the song. So we all please read with them on the screen as they start.
In Congress, July 4th, 1776, the unanimous declaration of the 13 United States of America, when in the course of human events, it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the political bands which have connected them with another, and to assume among the powers of the earth the separate and equal station to which the laws of nature and of nature's God entitle them, a decent respect to the opinions of mankind requires that they should declare the causes which impel them to the separation.
We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, that to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed.
That whenever any form of government becomes destructive of these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or to abolish it and to institute new government.
That these united colonies are, and of right ought to be free of independent state, that they are absolved from all alliances to British Crown, and that all political connections between them and the state of Great Britain is ought to be totally dissolved, that all as free and independent states that have the power to levy war, conclude peace, contract alliances, establish commerce, and to do all other acts and things which independent states may have right to do. And for the support and the declaration with a firm reliance and the protection of divine providence, we mutually pledge to each other lives, our fortunes, and our scarred honor.
Thank you. Father, Lord God, we come before your holy throne. Father, we are so thankful that you have blessed us to live in a nation, Father, that you have. We are very grateful as a people that you have allowed us to grow up in a land that is free to worship the way that we are free to worship. And Father, I'm thankful for the founding of our nation, that it was evident that your hand was upon this nation from the very beginning. So Father, today we pause and thank you for allowing us to be born and raised and live in this land. But Father, at the same time, we also are grieved over what happens inside our nation. That Father, that some of the things that we see going on break our hearts. I can only imagine what it does to you. And Father, it seems to me it's only because you are so long-suffering that you have not already sent judgment upon this nation. So Father, today, we as a group of people come and Father, we united together repent of the sins of our nation, from the things that your word clearly tell us are against you. Even the thought of 60 million babies that we have killed inside our own nation, Father. Let us, as a group of people, petition a plea to you for forgiveness. The Father, we would pray and we would ask that you would continue to have your hand upon us, but at the same time, would not be surprised if you would send your judgment. Father, I do pray for the men and women that serve this nation. And Father, the ones that are separated from their families. Father, I'm reminded even of the police officers and the firefighters with the tragedy that took place this past week in our own little community. Father, I'm thankful for the people that serve. Father, I do ask that today, that as we come to this hour and this time, that you would be glorified in all that we do and say, that your Holy Spirit would move, that Father, that the worship time that we move with would be pleasing to you, that the preaching of your word would glorify your name. And we ask this in the name of our Lord, our Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. You may be seated. God is good. All the time.
God is good.
Hey, some of the choir walking in the back, didn't they do a great job? Yeah, let's appreciate that choir. Brother Seth, thank you very much for quickly pulling that together. If you want to be a part of the choir, hey, it's not every time it's going to be a two-week turnaround. They'll start planning events and actually getting some more practice time in, but I thought it was certainly great to have them here singing this morning, so thank you all for the work and the time that you put into that. Hey, a few announcements we have this morning. First off, happy 4th of July. Amen? Yeah. Folks, we do live in a great nation. We really do. You have heard me oftentimes get up here and complain about the negative stuff that I see going on. But at the same time, folks, we are blessed. And I believe from the very founding of this nation that God has blessed us. And I pray that he continues to. And like I said in that prayer, I wouldn't be surprised if he doesn't judge us. But at the same time, I personally feel like I've been blessed because he's allowed me to live inside what I think is the greatest nation in the United States. But, folks, there's a lot of things that we need to change inside our nation as well. And I think it's only right that good men and women stand up and serve to help turn us back to the nation that we once were at the founding of our nation. Amen? Hey, back in our library, I want to make a couple announcements about our library. Our library is open, and I know people are going back and checking out books, but just a couple of quick announcements. First off, we've got several books that are duplicates, so they're sitting out there on their table, and they're free. And so if you would like one of those, we've got a duplicate, and you want to take it. Maybe you got a friend you want to give it to, so please grab one of those and take those. Along with that, we got a lot of Bibles. Maybe if you're here and you don't have a Bible, or you got a neighbor that doesn't have a Bible, we got a lot of Bibles back there. You can take one of those Bibles and have those as well. We want you to have God's Word. And so we've got several Bibles back there that we would love to give you. so that you would have that inside your home. And also they got one need, and that is for, what do you call those bookends? You know, those little things that hold the books up? If you've got some bookends that you could bring, they need some bookends so that it helps the books stay upright. And so we have that need. Now, I also, with this announcement, I wasn't really supposed to do this, but I'm going to. But Doug and Sharon, thank you all very much. They take care of our library, and they do an amazing, amazing job. And so, Doug and Sharon, thank you all for the work and the time and the dedication that they have. I see them every week back there getting books and bringing books in and sorting books. And so, thank you all so much for that service that that you do for our church. All right, our children that are with us, if you'd like to go to Children's Church, they're waiting for you right over here. So now, children that would like to go, it is now time for you to get up and come over and go to Children's Church. Now, as they are leaving, if you're a guest with us, in your chair pocket is a card in front of you, is a card that looks something like this. If you would take that and fill it out and drop it in our offering plate when you leave, as we would just like to thank you for being here with us and joining us for service this morning. We'd just like a record of your attendance. And with that, I'll turn it over to Brother Seth.
When I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hands have made, and I see the stars, and I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, and how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, and how great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God his Son, not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, and how great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, and how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, and how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, and how great thou art, how great thou art.
We all please sing with us.
Thank you. Christ's name, let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. The chosen seed of Israel's race, he ransomed from the fall. Hail him who saves you by his grace, and crown him Lord of all. Hail him who saves you by his grace, and crown him Lord of all. On this terrestrial ball, to him all majesty ascribe, and crown him Lord of all. To him all majesty ascribe, and crown him. Rich wounds yet visible above, in beauty glorified. No angel in the sky can fully bear that sight, but downward bends each burning eye at mystery's open. Crown him the Lord of life, who triumphed o'er the grave and rose victorious to the strife. Crown him with many crowns, the Lamb upon his throne. Hark how the heavenly anthem drowns all music but its own. Awake my soul and sing of him who died for thee. This king through all eternity. Oh, that with yonder sacred throne we at his feet may.
Y'all may be seated.
Man of sorrows, Lamb of God, by his own betrayed, the sin of men and wrath of God has been on Jesus laid. Silent as he stood accused, beaten, mocked, and scorned, in bowing to the Father's will, he took a crown. My salvation, where your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto thee. Sent of heaven's God's own Son, purchase and redeem, and reconcile the very ones who nailed him to that tree. And oh, that rugged cross, my salvation, where your love poured out over me. My soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor to thee.
Now my debt is paid.
Now my debt is paid. It is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me. Whom the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. Now my debt is paid, it is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me. Whom the Son sets free, oh, is free. My salvation, where your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto thee.
See, the stone is rolled away.
See, the stone is rolled away.
Hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah. God be praised. He's risen from the grave. Oh, that rugged cross, my salvation, where your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah. Praise and honor unto thee. Praise and honor unto thee. Praise and honor unto thee.
Y'all please take a moment and bow and just pray for the Holy Spirit to speak through Josh this morning as he gives us the word.
God is good, and all the time. Amen, amen. I, I'm not going to repeat what I said, but folks, I really do love this nation, and I know a lot of times I do get hard on it, but and I think there's a lot of things that we need to change, but I still think it's the greatest nation in all the world. Amen?
Amen.
Last week, we're going to pick up our study in the book of Matthew, and last week we looked where Jesus had been asked these series of questions from all the political leaders, the religious leaders and the lawyers of the day, and then it was Jesus' turn to ask a question, and Jesus asked them a question, and the question was about David and where David had, you know, whose son was the Messiah. And so we looked at that, and it was a powerful message that Jesus gave there as it left everyone silent. No one could speak. But before we start, I want to talk about something. I think the church needs to be a pure church. Amen? And whenever I say a pure church, I'm talking about a church that strives for holiness. I've often said that my concern with some of the teachings inside of Baptist churches is that we like to preach once saved, always saved. But folks, once saved, always saved has to go with the holiness of Christ and the expectation of living holy lives. You can't have one without the other. They go together. I think the church is called to be a holy church. The church is to be pure. The church is to be as a bride is waiting for her bridegroom, clothed in white, pure, without sin. And folks, I sometimes feel like I can get up here and I can preach. And sometimes it feels like some of the things I say just kind of fall on deaf ears. And so I've thought maybe it's time, instead of just continuing to preach the same messages, that maybe we change the standards for the church. Maybe it's time to say we as a church need to change the expectations that we have for the church. If we're going to be holy and separated from sin, then maybe we need some things in place that will say these are things, steps that we're going to take to keep us to be holy and separated from sin. Are y'all following what I'm saying? In other words, we have some set standards that say this will help us live a holy and pure life. Well, I've got four that I want to talk about this morning. Four things that I think could be expectations or requirements for the church. The first one, the number one place that pornography is looked at is on the internet. It's so freely available to everyone on the internet. Can I tell y'all something real quick, folks? I believe that looking at pornography is a sin. And I will continue preaching that that is sin, and that if you're looking at pornography, folks, you are living in sin. And remember, I'm saying that the church is to be holy and pure. By the way, the internet, not only is it the place, the number one place that people look at pornography, can I tell you this? The number one place that people look at it, not just on the internet, it's actually in their home. The number one place for people to look at pornography is on their home. So expectation number one. Y'all ready? Get rid of the internet in your house. No internet in your house. Expectation number two. Social media. God's word says that we are to meditate on God's word. And I will tell you, there is a lot of people spending a lot more time meditating on Facebook, Instagram, Frank Speaks, whatever. They're all over the place looking at social media, and they spend a lot more time dwelling on social media than they do on God's word. Amen? Expectation number two. 20 minutes a day is all you get to look at internet. I mean, look at Facebook, and I took internet out of your house, so you can't look at it there. But social media, 20 minutes a day, maximum. Expectation number three. Can I tell y'all something? Anytime you turn on the TV, there's nothing but trash. I did get an amen on that one. Folks, whenever you turn on the TV, that is constant. I just challenge you to do this. Well, you might not after my expectation, but I challenge you to do this. Just turn on any TV station and watch, and I will tell you, you are going to get things that are anti-God all the time. It's a place that has tore out the natural family and the way that God designed the family. Folks, we are called to be a pure and a holy church. And there is nothing that I want to get in between my walk with the Lord, and you should not want anything in your walk with the Lord that hinders that. So let's do this. Get rid of TVs in your house. The fourth one. God's word teaches us multiple things about gathering together as a church, about studying God's word. Fourth thing, be here. Be here. In other words, on Sunday mornings, Wednesday nights, Sunday school, when the church is open, you are here and you are engaged with God's people working to accomplish God's will inside your life because you want to know what God has to say. So you're not going to miss Wednesday night. You're not going to miss Sunday school. You're not going to miss a church service. If you miss more than one, then there's going to be an elder and a deacon that's going to come over to your house and visit you. If you miss more than one in a quarter. If you miss more than one in a quarter. An elder and a deacon will come visit you. There's four things that I wonder if we as a church should say. These are the expectation. This is the way that we're going to live. Why? Because we're going to be a holy, pure, separated church. Get rid of the internet in your house. Get rid of your TV, only look at social media 20 minutes a day, and show up to church every time the church is open. Is that so unreasonable to ask? To be holy and pure and separated, so that whenever we stand before a holy God, He will say, "Well done, my faithful child." We're going to pick up our study in Matthew chapter 23. We're going to read verses 1 through 12. So out of reverence for God's word, will you please rise as we look at Matthew chapter 23, verses 1 through 12. Then Jesus spoke to the multitudes and to his disciples, saying, "The scribes and the Pharisees sit in Moses' seat. Therefore, whatever they tell you to observe, that observe and do. And do not do according to their works, for they say, and do not do." Verse number 4. "For they bind heavy burdens, hard to bear, and lay them on men's shoulders, but they themselves will not move with one of their fingers. But all their works they do to be seen by men. They make their phylacteries broad and enlarge the borders of their garments. They love the best places in the feast, the best seats in the synagogues, greetings in the marketplace, to be called Rabbi, Rabbi. But you do not be called Rabbi, for one is your teacher, the Christ. and you are the brethren. Do not call one on earth your father, for there is one Father, he is in heaven. And do not be called teachers, for there is one teacher, the Christ. But he who is the greatest among you shall be the servant. And whoever exalts himself will be judged, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. Father, Lord God, the time has come for the preaching of your word. And Father, I pray that today that you would be glorified in this message. That Father, through this day that we would be drawn closer unto you, that we would have a better walk with you. Father, I pray that your Holy Spirit, the one that dwells with inside your believers, would control my heart, my mind, and my tongue. That Father, that this message is of you and not of me, and that you would be glorified. And Father, as we leave this place, maybe we have a deeper walk with you today. Because we've come and we've been in the presence of who you are. And we ask this in the name of our Lord, our Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. You may be seated. All right, now some of y'all have figured out that what I said this morning was just setting this up for the text. Amen? Did y'all get that? Amen? I want you to know that I was, because what they had done and what Jesus is addressing, at least in part of this, is the thought of all of these rules that are put on people to make people act and do a certain thing. And so I thought, wouldn't it be something if we started setting up these rules and expectations and saying this is the way that you have to act? And so I went through that process to make you think, what would it be like to have these heavy burdens that are placed on us? And how many of y'all were ready to get up and walk out? Amen? Be honest. Y'all were like, whoa. What's just talking about? Only 20 minutes on Facebook? I know some of y'all thought that. But don't miss the point. The point being that there had been these heavy burdens that had been put on people. These rules that had to be followed. And if you didn't follow these rules, then you were going to be lost and you couldn't follow them. Now just think about this. How about if I would have stood up here and I would have said all these things to y'all, said this, said, hey, no one in here can have internet in your house. You cannot be a member of this church if you have internet in the house. How about if I would have actually said that and said, that's truth, and you can't, if you have internet, then you're not a member of this church. How about if I went on to say, however, I need the internet in my house so that I can do research. Uh-oh's right. Now, by the way, none of y'all can watch TV anymore because TV is trash. However, I need to see what's being said on TV so that I will know how to handle the world, right? So it's okay for me. How about if I would have went that far this morning? Would you have wanted to get up and walk out then? Amen? You see, one of the things that Jesus is dealing with here, and by the way, he's only setting up for what's getting ready to come in the rest of Matthew 23. That we will continue to look at and we will teach through. But there were these all these rules that had been set up for people to follow. And the Pharisees had taken the word of God and what God said, and what they had said was, now we're going to add all of our rules on top of what God's word says. And so not only do you have to follow those rules, but you have to follow our rules. And guess what? Some of those were really good rules. It's not that the rules themselves were bad, but the Pharisees started treating their rules equal to what God's rules were. In fact, placing even more importance on their man-made rules over what God's word said. And so the Pharisees had set up all of these do's and don'ts and indicated that they were just as important as God's. Now, like I said, some of those weren't bad rules. And can I tell you all something? Those four things that I went through, none of those are bad. If you've got an issue with pornography, then I tell you, get the internet out of your house. Amen? But you don't need me to stand up here and tell you that. You should do that because you want to walk with the Lord and you've got a temptation, a burden that is on you that causes and helps you and hinders you with sin. And so in order for you to have a better walk with the Lord, you make the decision, you know what, it's not worth having internet in mass because all I do is look at stuff that I shouldn't be looking at. The same thing with Facebook. I shouldn't have to stand up here and tell you not to be spending all that time on Facebook. You should see that, man, every morning the first thing I do is get up and look at Facebook. I look at that before I even read God's Word. It shouldn't be that I have that any preacher should have to tell you do's and don'ts. It's not that those do's and don'ts are good or bad. It's that those do's and don'ts, you have to do that. It's about what's in your heart, about what causes you to do that. You could do that because I said it, but can I tell you something? If you do it because I said it, folks, that's not the reason for doing it. It's because you love the Lord. That's why you do it. Let me be very clear here, because I listed all those do's and don'ts. You all need to know we are saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ, not of our works, least anyone should boast. There is no do, there is no don't that is going to be able to get you into heaven. It's only the blood of Jesus Christ, and that's it. I don't need to add any do's or don'ts to that. That's the way you're saved. Amen? Your do's and don'ts from the convictions of your heart that God has laid upon you, that you do. Folks, I want you to know it is a very serious thing that Jesus is dealing with, but it happens inside our world today. I had a friend one time, and by the way, there's religions that live this out a lot, but they have all these rules of do's and don'ts that make you feel good. If I do this, if I do this, if I don't do this, then I feel good about myself. And so then I know that I am holy or I am spiritual because I do all my list of do's and don'ts. I had a friend one time that attends a church like that. And this friend one time was telling me that she had been kicked out of her church. It's like, you got kicked out of your church? She said, yeah, I can still go. I'm just no longer a member. I mean, like, you're not a member of your church. Why are you not a member of your church? She said, I go all the time. She's there Wednesday night. I mean, every time the door's open, she's there. But she's not a member. I was like, well, why did they kick you out? And it's because something she had done. I don't know what she'd done. I don't remember. But I asked her this question. I said, I got a question for you. Are you still saved? And she said, yeah. I said, so you're going to get to heaven? Yeah. If you died right now, you'd go to heaven. Yep, I'd go to heaven. So you're telling me that you would die, if you died, you'd go to heaven, but you can't be a member of that church? Isn't that church setting up stricter requirements than God is to allow you into heaven? Amen? She said, yeah. But that was okay. They had their list of rules. You had to follow the list of rules. Folks, let me tell you something. Religion built off rules is that. It's religion. Relationship with Jesus Christ is completely different. Amen? It's about a relationship with Jesus Christ. I do this and I do this and I do this. Your religions of rules, I'm going to tell you, can and will send lots of people to an eternity in hell. In fact, just as the last two Wednesdays, we've had some amazing missionaries that have come and spoke. But last Wednesday, whenever we had a lady, Rosa, come and speak to us, she's been a missionary for 35 years. But one of the things she was talking about in the Muslim religion was how rule-specific were. They had to do this. I mean, five times a day at the exact same time, they have to pray and they have to face a certain way. It's all about following the rules. Can I tell you something? I am more concerned about your relationship with Jesus Christ. In fact, I was going to get this later, but we'll just look at it right now. Back up to chapter 22, verse number 37. Here's the rule I want you to follow right there. If you will love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. Folks, can I tell you, that's the rule you have to follow. If you will do that, everything else takes care of itself. You don't have to worry about looking at pornography. Why? Because I love the Lord with all my heart, mind, soul, and strength. I don't have to worry about watching trash on TV. Why? Because I love the Lord with all my heart, mind, soul, and strength. I don't have to worry about Facebook because I do meditate on God's Word. Why do you meditate on God's Word? Because I love Him with all my heart, mind, soul, and strength. Folks, let me make sure you understand this point. It's not about the rules. It's about your relationship with Jesus Christ. not the rules. Not the rules that we follow. I want you to look at verse number 5 back in our text. Look at verse number 5. But all their works they do to be seen by men. They make their phylacteries broad and enlarge their borders. I mean, enlarge their borders. Their little tassel things. I'm saying it wrong. Please forgive me. You see, they have these phylacteries that they use. I want to show you a picture of what this is. Some of you might be saying, what when they use that word phylacteries, let's look at this first picture. Show this picture up on the screen. Y'all see that little square box on his head right there? Y'all see that little square box? That's a phylactery. That's what they would do, is to take this and they would put scripture inside of that little box. And so they walk around, and so you make these boxes more evident so that people would see them. It was to be seen. Now, go on to the next picture. Let me show you this next picture. You see this guy, he also has it on his arm there. You'll see he's got it wrapped around, and he's got one on his forehead and on his arm. Y'all see this picture, right? That's what it's referring to when it says that they make these phylacteries large. They've made them enlarged so that they can be seen. Now I want us to look at something. I want you to turn to Deuteronomy chapter 6. Flip over to Deuteronomy chapter 6. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse number 6. Now let's start in verse number 6 and look what it says. And these words which I command you today shall be on your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children. You shall talk to them when you sit in your house, when you walk by your way, when you lie down, and when you rise up. Look at verse number 8. You will bind them as a sign on your hand. Y'all remember the picture of the guy that had it bound? He had it bound on his arm there, bound on his hand. And then it says, and they shall be on the frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on your doorpost of your house and on your gates. Folks, what you saw the pictures of is what people were doing to live out what was written here in Deuteronomy. And so they had it attached to their hand, and they had it between their eyes. What did they have there? They have God's word placed inside their head. Now look at what it says there in verse number 6. I want you to notice what it says in verse number 6. It says, these words which I command you today shall be, where shall it be? On your heart. In order to get it on your heart, God told them to make sure they have it between their eyes and they got it attached to their hand. In other words, whatever you do and whatever you think, that's where you have God's word at. Amen? Y'all follow that? Now look what it says in verse number 6. And these words which I command you today. What are these words? I think you look back at verse number 4. Look at verse number 4 and 5. What are these words? Hear, O Israel, the Lord God is the Lord is one. Verse number 5. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength. What words were they to have between their eyes and attached to their arm, to their hand? What words were they to have there? Love the Lord thy God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. The words that they were to have bound are the same words that we just looked at over in Matthew chapter 22 when Christ said the greatest commandment and the thing that you need to have in your head and with what you do is to love the Lord thy God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, and all your strength. That's what you have bound. You see, folks, it's not about you following rules. It's about where your love is. It's where your love is. What you do with that. I want you to stay in Deuteronomy there for just a moment. So you got to love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your mind, with all your soul, and all your strength. And then verse number 6, these words I command you today shall be in your heart. Look at verse number 7. You shall teach them diligently to your children. Folks, If you're a mom, if you're a dad, if you're a grandma, if you're a granddad, you need to be teaching your children to love the Lord thy God with all their heart, all their mind, all their soul, all their strength. Amen? It goes on. It goes on to say, not only do you teach it to your children, it says that you need to live it out. You need to talk about it when you sit in your house, when you walk by your way, when you lie down, and when you rise up. You notice it said that it needed to be in your heart. Verse number 6, if you write in your Bible, and I encourage you to do it too, I ask that you would take and you'd put a little box around that last word there, heart, that you would have these on your heart. That you have God's word on your heart. Can I tell y'all something? I love our Awana program that teaches children to memorize God's word. Amen? I ask you to do this. How many of y'all want a good challenge? Anybody want a good challenge? Anybody up for a good challenge? In fact, I told my wife, I was like, I think I'm going to offer a reward for this. And she didn't think that was a good idea. And so I'm not going to do that. But I've got an idea. I've got a challenge for the church. Y'all ready for a good challenge? Y'all ready? Here it is. I challenge you to memorize Romans chapter 12. All of it. Yeah, I know. Sit here and go, what do you mean? Memorize the entire chapter? Memorize the entire chapter. In fact, I might not give a prize, but wouldn't it be cool if we had a wall that just said, Romans chapter 12, and if you memorize it and you could quote it, that you would get your picture, your name up there. By the way, that's a works thing, so I'm not going to require you to do that, but it would be kind of cool if we did. Let's flip to Romans chapter 12. Flip over to Romans chapter 12. I know some of y'all already started looking before I even said that, because you're like, what is Josh talking about? Flip to Romans chapter 12. And I will just tell you that I have tried to memorize the entire chapter. It's tough. But I want you to read some of these things inside of Romans chapter 12. And let me tell you something. You want to memorize a good scripture to have on your heart? Memorize this. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. Man, that's so good. That you are holy, that you are acceptable, God, which is your reasonable service. And not to be conformed to this world, to be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Folks, if we actually would take Romans chapter 12 and start putting that into practice, instead of just reading it, to actually renew our mind. And that we would prove that which is a good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Verse number 9. As you're memorizing this, jump down to verse number 9. Let us love without hypocrisy. Harbor what is evil. Cling to what is good. Verse number 10. Be kindly affectionate to one another with brotherly love. In honor, giving preference to one another. You know that if we would actually memorize that scripture so that it was on our heart, and then we started treating people the way that it says here in Romans chapter 12, you know what difference that would make inside your life? Amen? Look at verse number 14. Ha! Bless those who persecute you, and bless and do not curse. Verse number 16. Be of the same mind toward one another. Look at verse number 17. Repay no one evil for evil. Jump down to verse number 20. Therefore, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If they're thirsty, give him a drink. For in doing good, you will heap coals of fire on your head. Look at verse number 21 as you're memorizing Romans chapter 12, the last verse. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. Folks, you all want a good challenge? Memorize God's word in your heart. Memorize Romans chapter 12. Let's go back to our text. I got to figure out where I'm at now. Amen? Go back to our text. Because see, these people were really good at following the rules. They had rules that they had people following. But they had their rules so that people could see them. Look at verse number 6. They loved the best places in the feast and the best seats in the synagogue. Folks, the religious people of the day were practicing their religion for power, for authority, and things that made them feel good about themselves. Folks, your religion should have nothing to do with how good or bad you feel about yourself. Your religion should be about your relationship with Jesus Christ and nothing else. There's one thing that should matter. Am I loving the Lord thy God with all my heart, with all my mind, all my soul, all my strength? Folks, they cared about where they sat in the synagogue or how people greeted them. In fact, it says that they want people to call them rabbi. In fact, whenever I was studying for this, that term rabbi, there's actually three different words that can be used for rabbi. And they sound so similar. They're written just a little bit different, but they sound so similar. In fact, I'm going to spell them for you. One of them is R-A-B-H, one is R-A-B-B-I, and one is R-A-B-B-A-N. So all three of them, it's rabbi, rabbi, and rabban. And so all of them sound really close together. But do you know what they actually mean? Great, greater, and greatest. Their titles were set up to boast people and lift people up. Folks, our religion can't be about boasting and lifting ourselves up. It's about boasting and lifting up Jesus Christ and what he has done. Jesus is starting to address this issue right here with the way that the Pharisees would act and the things that they would do. He goes on and tells them here, you know, about being a teacher and not wanting to be a teacher, not letting anyone call you rabbi. Folks, can I just tell you something? In fact, you can go look it up. We don't have time for it, but go look up John chapter 16, verses 12 and 13. It says, the Holy Spirit was given to us to lead us unto all truth. You need to know that the teacher that you have dwelling inside you is the best teacher you could ever have in the Holy Spirit. You take the Holy Spirit and God's Word, folks, you don't need anything else. Amen? You don't need a book. You don't need a lecture. You have what you need. Now, I tell you, I encourage you, and I think you need to be in church. I think you grow. I think you grow in Sunday school. But it isn't a requirement. What is a requirement is the Holy Spirit teaching you all truth in his word. But I encourage you to come. I encourage you to read good books. But folks, don't take those good books over what this book says. I'm going to jump on down to the end here. I want you to look. I want you to look at what it says in verse number 13. I'm in the wrong chapter, sorry. Let's look at verse number 11. But he who is greatest among you, he who is greatest among you shall be a servant. Who is the greatest among us? The servant. And whoever exalts himself will be humbled, and he who humbles himself will be exalted. You see, I think that the issue that Jesus is addressing there with the Pharisees and everyone who is listening, and something that we need to know, is, folks, it's really about us being a humble servant of Jesus Christ. This passage here today isn't about the rules or the titles. It's about, are we being humble servants for Jesus Christ? In fact, whenever I thought about that, I thought about your service. What is your service like for the King? How are you serving God? How are you personally serving God? Helping people, reaching out to the sick, to the poor, to the ones that are in prison, to the ones that are hungry. What's your service to God look like? And then are you being humble with your service? Are you being a humble servant to your spouse, with your children, in the work that you do? Are you lifting up your spouse and your children? Are you honoring your mother and your father? You see, folks, to me, whenever I studied this scripture, I had to say, At what point will we stop worrying about all of our rules and start saying, if we love the Lord with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength, then we are going to be humble servants. We will be humble servants. See, if you put it all together, it starts back there in verse number 37. Do you love the Lord with all your heart and mind and soul and strength? And then it comes down to this question. If you love the Lord with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, then are you being a humble servant? Are you being a humble servant? See, that's the question for today, and the invitation is this. Is that you? Or are you somebody that you're not serving God at all? Oh, you like coming to church. You like the songs and the preaching. But you're not serving the Lord. That your religion is about the activity of going to church. Folks, that's just as bad as the rules about taking out internet. Your activity of thinking that your religion is attending church, that's just as bad. Are you being a humble servant for the King? Maybe you're here today and you're saying, Joshua, I've never truly been saved. I don't even know what it means to be a child of God. If that's true, then I want you to come and see me here in this time of invitation. But if you're here and you're saying, Josh, I've not been a humble servant, maybe you want to come to the altar and pray. Maybe you want to pray for a loved one. Whatever God has laid on your heart, if you will, please rise. As I lead us in prayer, Father, Lord God, I ask that you would have your way. During this time of invitation, Father, may you be glorified. Well, Father, I ask you'll move on people's hearts and draw them closer unto you. And we ask this in the name of our Lord, our Savior, Jesus, the Christ. Amen. Move however God has led you.
Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling for you and for me. See on the portals, he's waiting and watching. Watching for you and for me. Come home, come home. And ye who are weary, come home. Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling, oh sinner, come home.
Amen, amen. God is good. And all the time. Now, I just told you all that you don't have to follow those rules, but those rules are still good for you. So if you need to get rid of the internet, please do. Get rid of your television, but please do attend service as well, because not only will it bless you, it blesses me. Amen? There's a good, reasonable service for you. Hey, let's enjoy your Independence Day. Thank God for the country he's allowed us to be part of. Let's join hands with your family as we sing Family of God, and we're dismissed.
And I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain and cleansed by his blood. Join heirs with Jesus as we travel this sod, for I'm part of the family of God.